Hello, everyone. Welcome. I am exceptionally excited to talk to you today. Phase One and Megapixels Digital are coming together to give you this artist talk with Leif Steiner. My name is Zach Henderson. I work for Megapixels Digital. We are a Phase One partner based out of Colorado and Michigan. And we have actually Megapixels Digital's CEO on Murray Elliott today because we're going to do something a little bit different. First, I kind of want to go over some housekeeping. Basically, the talk is going to be set up into three different segments. And at the end of each segment, we're going to do a little contest. So I'll let Murray talk about that a little bit.
Hey, everybody. So the contest, what we plan to do is at the end of each segment, there's going to be a question and answer time. And then once that question and answer time is done, we're going to go ahead and we're going to open up the chat. And I'll ask a question about what you just heard Leif talking about. And the first person to answer that question correctly is going to win a swag bag from Phase One. And we're going to be giving away two of those. So stay tuned. Back to you, Zach.
Thanks, Murray. So if you guys have to head out at any point during the talk today, if you can't stay for the whole thing, don't worry. It is going to be recorded. You guys are going to be able to be sent a link after the recording is finished. So don't worry if you had to head out a little soon. If you're not familiar with Leif's work, you're really in for a treat today. I've had the pleasure of knowing Leif for a couple years now. He is as generous and kind as he is talented. We're going to be viewing some really incredible images today that he's taken from all over the world. And I'm really excited for you to hear his process, hear his thought process behind creating his images and some of the insane challenges that he has to deal with in some of these incredibly remote locations. So everybody, thank you for being here, and I'm excited to get to talk to you. Leif, how are you doing today?
Good. How are you doing, Zach?
Doing well, Leif. I'm going to go ahead and throw some images on the screen for us. So I think it's worth mentioning right off the bat that all of the images that we're going to be looking at today are in black and white. And that's because Leif shoots with an achromatic that is actually incapable of capturing color unless really specifically oriented in such a way to do so. So I think it's just interesting to keep that in mind as we look through these some of these really amazing images. I know we're going to kind of get into this a little bit more naturally, but I just want to start quickly with, you tell us about your background, Leif. How did you start into photography? How did you start considering making images like this?
The first thing I want to say is I'm sitting in an office in Mallorca in Spain, and there are people outside singing and dancing. So hopefully we don't have any audio issues here, but your question with how did I get into photography?
Yeah.
I think we're at this point, we're all born with a camera. There's more photos shot every day than were shot in the entire, 1900s. I have no idea when I shot my first photo. And in terms of how I got into photography, for me, it's just natural. I think we're all photographers, but I spent 20 years working in the creative industry, working as a creative director of an advertising agency. And for me, it was just a natural progression from that to this.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, it's clear that, you have this really incredible eye for composition and particularly for light. So obviously tell us a little bit about how you go about researching your subjects and tell us about, what your subject truly is. You sort of have described yourself as sort of like a cultural anthropologist in the past. Talk about that a little bit.
Yeah, so I'm working on a project kind of documenting indigenous traditional cultures around the world. I love culture, I love people, and I love some of the cultural traditions that still exist in kind of some of the, more remote parts of the world. How do I research the stuff? Google's easy, in 30 minutes, it's easy to come up with a lifetime worth of work. But in terms of the logistics, I get asked this a lot on Instagram, how do you arrange for some of these to shoot some of these in some of these locations, some of these people, et cetera. I usually have multiple destinations in the works at any given time. Before the COVID crisis, I was making plans for Pakistan, Ethiopia, Morocco, Papua New Guinea, Myanmar, and Iran all at the same time. In April, I was trying to shoot in Iran, shoot in Morocco, and Ethiopia. I just kind of had my list and working with, you know, multiple people, multiple countries. And then usually what ends up coming through is where I ended up going. But, you know, it's amazing. Once you put yourself out there, people tend to help you. It's amazing how many people I've had say, oh, I have an uncle who's the cultural minister of XYZ country. I'd like to introduce the two of you. I wanted to shoot in Iran, and at the same time, I had two or three people reach out to me from Iran. And so that next thing, and I was connected with a professor in Tehran who spent about a month trying to help me with visas, logistics, et cetera. This is all before the virus hit. But in terms of logistics, I think when you really want to make something happen, it's amazing how many doors open up with people who are interested in helping you. I just had a message about 20 minutes ago from someone who was inviting me to Central America saying, hey, I would love to assist you with a trip down here. So when you want to do something, people are there to help.
That's fantastic. I love that. Yeah. It's kind of falling in your lap. That's great. Do me a favor, talk about this image a little bit. You know, I'm scrolling through these and I definitely want to, you know, spend a little time on one in particular. But, you know, this first section, tell us a little bit about, you know, the logistics behind this shoot. You know, what were some of the challenges and who are these people?
This is Papua New Guinea. Papua New Guinea is an incredible part of the world. It was cut off maybe 45,000 years ago as the oceans rose. And so you have 45,000 years of cultural evolution. In Papua New Guinea, there's still, I believe, over 800 tribes and 800 languages. The people are remarkable. They're remarkably intelligent. In fact, as you taken as a whole, I would say they're the most intelligent people I've ever met. And just culturally diverse. It's really phenomenal. The people who live in the highlands are very different than the people who live on the coasts. And it's just a fascinating, fascinating place. So I was there last year photographing, had the opportunity to photograph probably about 70 different tribes. These photos that you're showing right now are just different portraits of different people. I tend, when I shoot, in the case of Papua New Guinea, I didn't seek out the people to photograph. I kind of set up my system and let people come to me. So that everyone who was photographed are people that wanted to be photographed. At any one point, okay, I would have 10 to 30 people who wanted to be photographed. And so I kind of had the opportunity to pick and choose who I took portraits of. I do have one funny story about shooting in Papua New Guinea. There was a man I wanted to photograph. He was iconic. He was just absolutely incredible looking. And I had four assistants, locals, with me, acting as, you know, holding the gear, holding backdrops, protecting equipment. So I had four assistants, and there were maybe 150 people watching. And this guy was ready to be photographed. He was an older guy, and but he wanted a cigarette first. So he asked one of the assistants for a cigarette. The assistant gave him a cigarette, but didn't give him a lighter. He didn't ask for a lighter. He had the cigarette. So he gets down on the ground. He gets into a pouch, pulls out a stick, a bunch of moss, and he makes a fire by hand on the ground, lights a cigarette, stands there for about 5 minutes, smokes a cigarette very slowly. We're watching him. He's watching us. We're all just waiting. He finishes his cigarette and then absolutely rocks it in front of the camera. It was amazing. Shooting in Papua New Guinea was phenomenal. The people were amazing. Some of the most kindest, generous, I don't know, intelligent people I've ever met. So these
That's
photos right now are
play,
all portraits of yeah, exactly. These are all portraits of people that I photographed in Papua New Guinea. Some of them, you know, look rather fierce. You can't get them to smile. And then the minute you're done shooting and you show them the back of the camera, they get all excited and they're laughing, but then you hold the camera up and they stop smiling. So it's always funny.
I think this one is really worth looking. I mean, obviously all of these images are extraordinarily sharp, but I wanted in particular this one, I wanted to zoom into 100% and really just kind of let everybody take in the detail that's in all of these images. Every single one of these has detail like this. And it's amazing. So we talk a little bit about the achromatic. I mean, I think it's such an interesting move to choose a camera that is incapable of shooting color, but it's sort of like a trade-off, right? You're giving up the ability to shoot color for all of this extraordinary detail and tonality. Talk about that. What is it like shooting with a large medium format camera in these places?
Well, shooting with black and white, you know, color, I love color photography. But I photograph in black and white for three reasons. You know, humans, we love color. We react to color. Color's powerful. Color has a lot of personality. Even good color photography has the hallmarks of the era in which it was shot. You can fake a good color photo, but you can't fake a black and white photo. Black and white is brutally honest. So I shoot with black and white because to me, it's much more true. There's something about black and white that it's not that it's timeless, but to me it stands. It can stand. Color doesn't distract from the content. We'll put it that way. On a more pragmatic note, I want consistency across my work. And when you're shooting in different conditions, sometimes you're shooting the same people. Sometimes you're working on the same shoot over the course of hours or days or weeks. I shot in Peru for 3 months, and in Peru, you had snow, you had sun, you had wind, you had rain, you had completely blue skies. You have all of these different color worlds that when you're photographing the same group of people, from day to day, the color worlds change. So when you're shooting black and white, you eliminate that variability of color. I think lastly, color can be saved digitally, but no color print is truly, truly archival. Whether it's 5 years or 500 years, color inks eventually fade, where black and white carbon-based inks, in theory, will last thousands of years. So I love color photography, but for me, black and white is more befitting of this particular project. And then the achromatic, phase one achromatic, amazing camera. You know, you just zoomed in on the file, and I think the viewers should know that this is a low res image compared to the high res images that come out of the camera itself. You know, you always have to be careful when you show people, when you show your subject their portraits afterwards, because you don't zoom in too far. First, it's like, here's your face, here's your nose, here are the pores on your nose, here's the sweat coming out of the pores on your nose. People get freaked out when they see how high of resolution the camera can shoot.
Sure, yeah.
And you just zoomed in. But I can tell you that the actual image is significantly sharper and more detailed than what's even showing up here. You can see me.
And that's saying something because I'm just able to. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah, we can see you shooting and your umbrella, and I mean, and actually, really clearly defined. You know, there's your arm, there's the camera, shoulder, the light. So it's. It's amazing, and the fact that it's even a lower res version than what is already there. It's just, I don't know, it's just kind of blowing me away.
I was actually looking at one photo from Africa, and you could see in the reflection of the person's eyes, you could see me, you could see my face, and you could see the whites of my eyes in the reflection of their eyes. And it was about the same proportion. So It wasn't a close up of the person's face. It was about like this. So the resolution is phenomenal.
That's amazing. So I mean, these, you know, the camera that you're shooting with, the achromatic, the XF, you know, the lenses, they're not tiny. Talk a little bit about how, you know, what it's like getting you know, this kind of equipment into these, I mean, really far removed locations at times.
You know, the hardest part about traveling is actually hauling all of the equipment. And that has nothing to do with phase one. It's just hauling lighting, hauling batteries, hauling you know, the cameras and all of the stuff. It's a big camera, but for me, it's no different than shooting with a. I shot with a Leica monochrome before this camera. Beautiful camera to shoot with. It's nice. It's lightweight. But for all intents and purposes, this camera's no different. It's not like I have to work out at the gym to carry the camera around. It's a big camera. But you know, the funny thing is, people get confused by the camera. You know, most people have seen cameras. Most people have seen your standard 35 millimeter camera. Very few people have seen a camera that looks like this camera. That helps when you're getting into a country and you're going through customs. I was going into Peru and they wanted to charge me import tax on the camera. And I said, it only shoots in black and white. And they said, it only shoots in black and white. And I'm like, yeah. And they're like, oh, this is a cheap camera. And they let me through. So I was like, cool, thank you.
That's amazing. I love that.
Yeah.
So what does shooting with medium format allow you to do? What is that? Does that give you additional tools and things that you can use after the fact that another camera might not be able to?
Well, as you know, like a medium format, you just have the resolution, the amount of pixels you're working with allows you to crop in if you really want to. I was working with a fine art printer about a year ago. I mean, he prints the work of extraordinary photographers who you know, shot amazing work. And he was looking at the files and he said, there's really just infinite pixels to work with here. And it's true, shooting with this camera, I want to compose the shot in the camera, but you can really zoom in and crop as you want. You have access to more pixels than you'd ever dream of. You know, plus beyond that, medium format just has a look that I love. You can tell the difference between a 35 millimeter and a medium format just off of the look. And it's I had a Pentax 6x7 when I was in college. And never look back. In the meantime, I've had 35 millimeter cameras, but medium format, there's nothing that, it's a perfect marriage. It's the perfect balance between a large format and a 35 millimeter. There's something special about that format.
I love that. That's great. Yeah. Well, guys, so I think we're starting to move towards the end of the first segment. If you've got some questions, I'm going to take a peek real quick to see if we have any specific questions coming in. We do have a few. Move over on one image, and I'm going to start asking a couple of these questions. Okay, so first question from Bora Somme. I apologize if I do not pronounce your name correctly. So Bora asks, how do you fund the work?
How do I fund the work? good question. You know, these trips are not always inexpensive, but travel does not need to be expensive. I've been traveling since my early 20s, and when I had no money, I did road trips. Eventually, I looked for cheap flights. I live in the U.S. I think one of my first trips was I found an incredibly inexpensive ticket to Rome. It was flying like 3 days later, and I slept homeless on the streets for a couple days. I don't think my parents want to know that, but you know, later I bought a ticket to Guatemala. I don't speak Spanish. Landed in Guatemala, had no idea what I was doing or where I was going. So even when you're, you know, even on a small budget, you can figure out how to get places. I worked in the advertising industry for years, saved up some money. And now I have a little bit of a healthier budget to work with, but everything is self-funded. I'm not sponsored. I'm not selling anything. No one's paying me for the photos. It's more of a pursuit of passion than anything else.
Another really good question, in particular. So what are you using as a light source? We saw a little snippet of that in the pupil of one of your subjects, but talk a little bit about what you're using for lights.
Yeah, the phase one system is set up to work in conjunction with Profoto. Profoto does great equipment, but I shoot with the wrong color lighting. I love the parabolic lighting that Broncolor has. Beautiful lighting, a good modifier, good lighting always makes a big difference. I'm sure you could capture the same look and feel with Profoto, but for all intents and purposes, Broncolor is the equipment that works best for me. Specifically, the parabolic lighting. A lot of companies make lighting that has a little bit of a kind of parabolic feel to it, and I really like how the light wraps around the subject. Beyond that, it's just experimenting with what's working and what fits the look you're going for.
Makes sense. Do you process your own photos, or are you working with your images, your own images in Capture One, I assume?
Yes, Capture One. Yeah. There's not a lot of post-production. I prefer, like, you know, this to me is a pursuit of passion. The last thing I want to do is spend hours editing photos. So what you see is Capture One, you know, maybe adjusting exposure levels, maybe adjusting you know, small details, take it into Photoshop, export it, and then that's that. If it's in the image, it's in the image. I'm not doing a bunch of editing. Typically, I'll shoot a lot of photos of each person. Sometimes I'm shooting 100 or 150 images of each subject. And, you know, there are images where the person looks amazing, but there's a fly sitting right on their face. I don't believe in removing that fly. If it's there, it's there. But on the other hand, sometimes you have a fly on someone's face, you just end up with, I don't know, maybe additional commentary on the photo that you don't need. So I'll pick a different photo. I don't think photos should be over edited. I think there's something true and truthful about just light editing, stuff that you could traditionally do in a dark room, and nothing beyond that.
Sure. So guys, we're getting some great questions. Unfortunately, I can't get to all of them, but we're gonna do our best to circle back at the end and answer as many as we can. Murray, if you're able, I think we can take a break and do our first giveaway. You're ready.
Sounds great. Hey, everybody. I hope everybody can hear me okay. Excellent so far, guys. Appreciate everything. For those who have just signed in, though, we mentioned at the beginning that we're doing a giveaway between the first and second segment, and then again for the second and third segment. I'm going to ask one simple question, and the first person, I'm going to open up the chat to everyone, and you'll see the chat down on the bottom of your screen. I'll open up the chat to everyone. The first person to answer it correctly is going to win a swag bag from phase one. So hope everybody's ready. First question, and I'm going to open up the chat here real quick. Give me just half a second. Okay. First question. What is special about Leif's camera? We're going to announce the winner to that one between the second and the third, and I'm going to get off screen again. Thanks, everyone.
Nice. I like that. It's a good question. Okay. So we're kind of in segment two now. And so as we're changing segments, we're going to start looking at another series of images. I'd love, Leif, if you could talk just a little bit about where we are now and the kind of images that we're looking at in this place.
This is Myanmar. This is in February and March. I have a contact in Myanmar. I was there several years ago and worked with him to photograph a bunch of the tribes and get into some of the guerrilla controlled areas. Some of these areas haven't been accessed in decades. Working with him, he spent a long time on logistics and kind of coordinating with different guerrilla groups to get into some of these areas. But all these images you're looking at now were photographed of kind of indigenous groups in Myanmar, various kind of locations around Myanmar. That woman that you just had up, she was an absolute gem of a human. And you don't see it in the photo, but they're all extremely short. I frequently was sitting on the ground trying to photograph them. Some of these people were just over four, some of the women were over just over 4 feet tall, maybe 4 feet six, but very small. And some of them are quite old. They're living in conditions, no electricity, no real running water. So you might be getting water out of a stream. And you had people in their 90s. It was incredible seeing healthy people in their 90s living in very remote areas in very simple conditions. It just goes to show you that that healthy living, I don't know like how to articulate it, but healthy, simple living, you know, anywhere.
You know, it seems like, you know, you get exposed to a lot of different cultures and you know, sometimes dramatically different cultures. It seems like these cultures will have different priorities and, you know, different ways of thinking about life in general. I mean, is that one of the best things about traveling? I mean, what is the best thing about getting to travel and shoot at these really remote locations? What do you enjoy the most about it?
You know, humans are the same all over the world. We all need to eat. We all need to sleep. It's amazing. I was in Pakistan. I hitchhiked the length of the Pakistan-Afghanistan border, and you show up in these remote villages, and inevitably some kid comes and grabs your hand, and you end up spending the night in his parents' house, and they feed you. There's no language in common. It's just amazing how it doesn't matter where you are in the world. We're all the same at the end of the day. Belief systems can be radically different. You have cultures that are very individualistic, and you have cultures that are very collectivist. You have cultures that have a high power differential between authority and, you know, people kind of down below. You have cultures that have a very low power differential. You have cultures that have a very linear sense of time versus a like polychronic sense of time, where they'll say, I'll be here at this time, and it's within plus or minus like 5 hours, usually minus 5 hours or plus 5 hours. It's just, yeah, it's yeah. So, I mean, it's amazing. It's amazing experiencing different people, different ways of thinking, and just a different approach to the world, just a different approach to life. And, you know, we all work, and some of us work quite hard. And it's easy to get wrapped up in our jobs, our lives, and think that this is all there is. And, you know, once you step out your front door, you realize that the world has 1,000 different ways of seeing the world, and 1,000 different ways of approaching life, and 1,000 different ways of loving, 1,000 different ways of just 1,000 different philosophies. And I think most people are good people. It doesn't matter where you go in the world, they're good people. There's a few bad people and a lot of good people out there. And the more you travel, the more you realize that I think we all operate off the same operating system. We may have different skin colors, we may have different beliefs, but we're all the same.
Sure. Yeah, important message right now. So, you know, you kind of mentioned, you know, before, there's a lot of, most people are good, and then there are a few bad people. So you mentioned that you're trying to go through the getting to Myanmar and trying to get into some places that are, I think you said, guerrilla controlled. You know, what's there's some danger involved in some of these shooting locations. How do you manage that?
How does my mother manage that?
Same question.
The reality is what you hear on Fox News is far from the truth. I am not concerned, like Pakistan, take Pakistan, for example. You take your average person's perception of Pakistan, especially post 9/11, would be that it's dangerous. Even in the tribal territories, you would say it's dangerous. It's about the most hospitable, friendly country. It's as hospitable and friendly as any place I've ever been. I have never really felt in danger in some of these places. Pakistan, Myanmar, not at all in Myanmar. The places that I feel most in danger are places where there's like a lack of, you know, like certain, I love Mexico City, but certain neighborhoods in Mexico City, I am more nervous in Mexico City or maybe parts of Los Angeles than I would ever be in, say, Pakistan, you know, or Papua New Guinea. With poverty, you have people who are desperate. And with poverty, you have people that will do things that they wouldn't do otherwise. With poverty, you do have the chance of getting robbed. People people, they need food. And, but when people have food and people are doing all right, it's just a very small subset of the population tends to have kind of malintent. But in terms of people who, encountering people with genuine malintent, very, very, very rare. So, I don't know if I answered your question, but I think it's a
little bit. No, you certainly did. I think so. I think a lot of it, I think it, from what I gleaned, a lot of it is just mental. And places typically are more hospitable than not in most cases, which makes sense. So thinking about, kind of really bringing it back to photography, what, what's your biggest photo fail? You know, we're looking through these, your A-list, right? We're looking through some of these really incredible images. Surely at some point in your life, you've taken some bad photos. So what's your biggest photo fail?
These aren't my photos. I just Googled them earlier today and looked for black and white images and sent them over to you guys. Yeah. Now, as far as I'm concerned, every photo is a success and every photo is a failure. What I shoot tomorrow would be better than what I shot yesterday. Like, failing is not learning. If you're learning, then you're not failing. Like I look at the photos I shot last year and say, what can I do that's better? Sometimes I like a photo and I say, okay, if this is a 9 or 10 out of 10, what would it be if it was a 5 out of 10 and how would I improve it? Can I smell this photo? Can I taste the photo? Can I hear the photo? I always look at photos from a perspective of like, does it work on a conceptual level? Does it work on an emotional level? Humans are emotional creatures and we're rational creatures. We have these like kind of two like components. Does it stimulate the brain? Does it stimulate the intellect? Does it stir the soul? Like, how do you kind of capture all of that? And as I'm looking through photos, I want something that has a certain energy to it, a certain personality to it. I want something that sits in the viewer's mind after the photo's gone. Here, you have this photo up right now. Let me pause on this real quick. Skip to the next photo. Let's look at the next photo real quick. And then go back. So you see the rings on her neck. Let's go back to the previous photo. This is one of the few women in this tribe who has had her rings removed. And there's this myth that when they take the rings off that they die. But that's not true. The reality is that they lack the neck muscles after having the rings on their necks for, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 years. So this particular woman, she was a gem of a human. She wrapped a towel around her neck to support her neck for 3 years in order to gain the muscles in order to hold her head up. But she's not smiling here, but her whole her personality is one of absolute joy. They like the rings on their necks. It's considered to be beautiful. I forget the reason she took them off. I think she was having some problems of some sort. But this particular woman, I like the energy of this photo. I like the motion of her hands. When I'm kind of looking at a photo and trying to figure out what's working, what's not working, I'm really looking for the tangible and the intangible, that marriage of like, do we have something that we won't forget? If you're walking down the street and you saw someone who is 5 meters tall, you'd remember that person for the rest of your life. How do we create a photo that has that equivalent, like 5 meter tall person in it? Not every photo is going to be iconic, but at least we can strive to create imagery that resonates beyond the thousands of images we see every week,
Sure, absolutely. So talk about, obviously, all of these are portraits. Are you using like a traditional portrait lens? Do you have like a specific type of lens that you're using? What's in your kit?
I have the 55 and the 105. I shoot with the Schneider 55 almost exclusively. Easy lens, great lens, just in terms of how I set up the lighting, it allows me to get in front of the lighting. In this particular image, the lighting was behind the woman, behind and to the side. But there's other photos where the lighting is between me, or sorry, the lighting is behind me. I am between the lighting and the subject. And sometimes the lighting is 4 feet in front of the subject or 5 feet in front of the subject. So I've got this huge parabolic light, the subject's right here, and I'm trying to squish in the middle. When you're shooting with like the 105, you're too far away, you can't get in there. The 55 is perfect. If you're shooting with a wider lens, you get too much distortion. So for me, the 55 is an amazing lens for shooting portraits. You get a little bit of distortion, but on the other hand, you get the ability to get up, you get it to get a lot closer to the subject than you can with a 105, et cetera.
And that focal length is really kind of similar to, you know, a 35 millimeter in 35 millimeter term. So it's that really favorite reportage sort of environmental portrait, you know, kind of go-to focal length. So that makes a lot of sense. And in fact, you know, this is not necessarily one here, but, you know, we've been looking through some images. And this is a perfect example where, you know, you're showing like a lot of these are environmental portraits. Some are less so. Some are really more about, you know, it's head and shoulders. And we're really seeing an individual, but in this case, we're seeing part of the environment. So how do you choose? Do you shoot like, is it sort of depending on where you are? Is it the location is interesting? Do you go for an environmental portrait or, you know, how do you choose like a head and shoulders portrait or environmental?
lots of questions in that question.
Yeah, there is. Yeah.
The first thing I would say is when I'm shooting, you would not want to see my camera. It has tape all over it for multiple reasons. But for dust, I don't like to switch the lens because when I'm shooting, there's a lot of dust. And when you're switching the lens and you're in the field for 3 weeks or 4 weeks, I don't want dust in the sensor or in the camera. So I tend to just leave one lens on and I use electrical tape and tape up the camera. Other reasons I tape up the camera, so just to reduce the chance of it being a target. You know, you go some places and people like to walk around with their Leica and show off the Leica name. I would prefer for my phase one to be just an anonymous camera. Luckily, when you're in these places, no one knows what it is. So you don't really have to worry about getting robbed, but my camera is just covered up. I don't take off the lens. And then when it comes to shooting in these environments, there are times where the environment, like this shot in particular, this is in Peru, where the environment it's just got a lot of atmosphere. It's got a lot of emotion. I want to capture the environment. Papua New Guinea, the environment was really busy. I did spend some time photographing people, you know, in their villages. I shot people in the jungle. But what I noticed, because I'm shooting in black and white, there's not a lot of differentiation between the people in the background. The background is busy. The people are busy. They're very decorated. They're wearing their ceremonial gear. They're very visually busy. And when you put them against a busy background, they disappear. So with Papua New Guinea, after shooting for a certain amount of time, I started just putting a black backdrop behind people, really showcasing them. In Peru, these are the Quechua. This is shot at about 14,500 feet elevation. Same with this. You got these big open landscapes. You have clouds kind of going in and out of the mountains, up and down the valleys. So it's beautiful. You got these neutral backdrops. And so I try to, in this case, I shoot more environmental stuff, still portraits, but I'm kind of pulling back a little bit to capture some of the environment. I think in a dream world, everyone would be photographed in the environment. The reality is when you have a limited amount of time to shoot, sometimes the environment fights with the portrait itself. So it really just depends, you know, when and where I'm shooting close-ups, backdrops, or in the environment.
Sure. You know, I mean, I think it's really lovely how these backgrounds change and the balance that you've struck with the ambient light and, you know, the strobe that you're using, because it's just really nicely, subtly dialed down. And all of the attention is on the subject and you've got this really nice placement. And certainly in this one, it seems like just this three-quarter, you know, the light's just cascading off of the subject and it's really beautiful. Are you using the same, and you may, forgive me if you may have already answered this, but are you using the same lighting setup sort of in each location? I know that you change its position, but is it the same brown color umbrella essentially every time, or are you making different choices?
I have three different brown color modifiers, but I use one. And that one, you can adjust the distance from the light from the inside. So like a with the parabolic lighting, you can focus it, you can pull it out. So there is some, but honestly, I'm not as methodical as you might think I am. I see the subject, I get a feel for what I'm trying to shoot, and then I just play around with it. I don't test for exposures. I shoot it, look in the camera, look at the histogram. I shoot some more, look at the image, look at the lighting, and adjust. It's more of like an analog, shoot 5-10 photos to really like see what it feels like rather than kind of pre-analyze it. And I make a lot of adjustments. Like I said before, I probably shoot 100 or 150 images of each person over the course of several days or sometimes just several hours. And some of the photos look bad and some of the photos look good. And when you have enough photos, you can, it's amazing what you think looks good the day you're shooting. Sometimes you get it, you get home and you open up in the computer, you're like, this is flat. This doesn't have the emotional resonance that I wish it had. Other times there's photos, I've had photos where I thought that they were terrible in the field. I get home and I look at it, I'm like, wow, this just has a certain hard to define quality to it. So I'll stop there.
Sure. No, gotcha. So I think
at this point, a lot of experimenting. A lot of experimenting constantly. Yes.
Yeah. No, that makes sense. You have the time, you have the ability. Makes sense. So I think we're going to open Q&A again for this second segment. I'm cheating a little bit because I know of some of your stories from this particular shoot, and I think this question is a perfect segue into those. So what does the culture clash feel like? What have you learned from these people, but also what have they learned from you?
Oh, what have they learned from me? It was interesting. 100 years ago, 200 years ago, there were thousands of different cultures around the world, and we're rapidly becoming a very homogenized kind of global one world civilization. So very cognizant of too much influence. In Africa, I was photographing a tribe in Africa, and I ended up giving the guy my t-shirt. He was just an amazing guy, but I have this debate that goes on inside my head, because you give someone a t-shirt and then they stop wearing maybe their traditional clothes. If I was the guy, I'd want to wear a t-shirt also. But what happens when the weaving traditions are lost? I mean, it's a slow erosion of like kind of cultural traditions. And so when I'm interacting with people, I prefer to not have too much influence or, I don't know, evangelize like any sort of my own belief system or any sort of, I would prefer to be tread lightly. I would prefer to have a low impact on the cultures that I'm kind of interacting with. You know, a lot of people in a lot of cultures are fully like cognizant of the contemporary world. We'll just put it that way. But in Peru, for example, you know, within a mile of here, I photographed a guy. He had no concept of countries, oceans, I don't know. It's like, it's this, you know, I'll leave that debate for someone who's put more thought into it than myself. But, it's funny when people talk about airplanes, they said, have you been in one of them? In terms of me influencing them, I prefer to keep my influence to a minimum. I prefer to not leave much of an impact. Like when you're in Africa and you're drinking a water bottle, they want the plastic water bottles because it makes it easier when they're getting in the well to store their water. But every time you give away a plastic water bottle, that plastic water bottle is like sitting around the village. It just becomes, you know, in my eyes, it looks like trash. To them, it's got a lot of utility. But in terms of what I've learned, I look at the Quechua in Peru, and I look at one community in particular Keros. And some people feel that or believe that the Keros are the last kind of remaining group of like descendants of the Incas. And if you Google Keros and you Google the Quechua, you'll have a lot of like new age people who love to assign all sorts of mystical kind of beliefs and teachings from them. But the reality is there are simple people living in the mountains, living a simple existence. And you have new age people in Europe and the US who credit them with all sorts of like mystical, magical, like this is how we need to live our lives and stuff like that. But the reality is you spend time with them, and I spent weeks with them. I don't know how to like articulate this. It's like, I feel like I'm
sure.
Yeah. I'll have to move on to the next question.
I think you've answered it. I think you've answered it. I think you've given a good glean into that. We do have a lot of these really great questions. And so let's try to get through at least three or four more before we move on to the next segment and do the giveaway and announce the winner to the last one. So this was a pretty simple one. So how big of a team do you travel with? Seems like a fairly big production. Is it just you?
Myself. Yeah. Yeah, I love photographing with other people. I love working with other people. But at this point, just traveling with myself. And if I need assistance, I'm working with local guides, right. Local people. You can never beat the kind of on the ground local guides.
Sure, right. How do you share and promote your work to be seen? I know your advertising background has helped you with that strategy, most likely.
No, I'm actually, I post on Instagram. I don't have a website. There are a lot of people who love self-promotion. I have a little bit of an aversion to self-promotion. Right now, Instagram, at some point I'll have a website up. It's in the works, but I'm really doing this. It's a passion project. It's not designed to push out into the world. And I have probably 15,000 images. Out of those 15,000 images, there's probably 500 that I could easily post that I think are strong photos. I don't know how many I've posted on Instagram, maybe 30. So people who follow me on Instagram, I get messages like, why haven't you posted in a month? For me, it's I can post every day, but I'm pretty shy about this stuff. I post every now and then and that's it. So
are you printing your work or are you just primarily on Instagram?
On Instagram. There is a printing system called Paisography by Cone Editions out of Vermont. They do have an incredible printing system, printing with 7 to 10 colors of carbon-based inks. And at some point I will be using their system to print up some of these images. Your traditional inkjet printer, you know, it may have a lot of different ink colors, but you're only really using the black when you're printing black and white. So the Paisography system creates a phenomenal image. I will be printing in the future, but not now. So
yeah, one more question for you before we go for the contest. I could not think of that word. So last question, how do you get access to photographing your subjects? And I know we've covered that a little bit. Do you work with fixers? Do you pay your subjects? And how do you navigate that? Are they just happy to pose for you? Or are you giving them something in return? How do you navigate those waters?
Fixers, I think that's a yes. So I'm working, I work with on the like in-country guides. I work with people who either know the tribes or have access. Like in Myanmar, I worked with a guy, a good friend of mine actually, who has relationships with a lot of different people. And he worked on getting access into some of the guerrilla controlled areas. And what does that mean? At the end of the day, it means bribes. It means you're paying off some commander to get in. And it was really interesting. You're going through these like semi-military checkpoints and you have to have kind of prepaid off everyone to get in. it is just how it is. In terms of subjects, I always compensate the people I photograph. Like, I feel it's the right thing to do. I'm not selling any photos, but who knows what's going to happen in the future. Do I do a book? Do I sell photos? I feel it's the right thing. I am taking some of their time. I am kind of taking their photo. I think everyone I've photographed has loved being photographed. Frequently, people are lined up. In Africa, people are lined up 50 people deep waiting to be photographed. Same with Papua New Guinea. There are more people to photograph than you can ever photograph. So people want to be photographed, but I feel it's my responsibility to compensate people. Sometimes people want money. Sometimes people want food. Usually people don't want anything, but I'll you know, in Peru, up way up in the mountains, money has no real need. So I would bring kilos of rice, kilos of salt, sugar, pasta, just sugar, yeah, staples like that. So when I would photograph someone in Peru, I would give them, you know, probably a 20 kilo bag of food afterwards. The same with Papua New Guinea, it was frequently food. Other places, maybe it's money. Myanmar, it was money. But it's always, to me, it feels like I'm taking their time. I feel responsible for compensating them in one way or another. Even though people would love to be photographed and love to be photographed without charging anything, I feel it's the right thing to do.
Yeah. Okay. So I think we are ready to announce the winner of the first question and ask another question for some swag. Are you there?
Yeah, man. Excellent. Yeah. So the first question that we asked was, what is special about Leif's camera? And Roman H from the UK had answered correctly. It's a phase one medium format achromatic camera system. Now, for everybody that maybe some of you missed the first part, but we are going to ask a second question. And if you go into the question section, you can go ahead and post your answer there. And we'll go ahead and announce the winner of that question at the end of this next segment. The next question, number two, what lens does Leif enjoy shooting most often? Bye-bye.
All right. Hope you're listening. So of these images that we've seen in Patagonia, you know, these are really, they're obviously, they're all striking, but these are some of the ones that I certainly, myself, I've seen the most and really just am drawn to. You've kind of described yourself in the past as something along the lines of a cultural anthropologist, and sort of have, talk a little bit about what you feel like do you have a responsibility to help preserve some of these cultures?
Oh, that's a dangerous question. I think when you start talking about preserving people, you stray into a territory that's can really light some people up. We'll put it that way. I don't think it's my job to preserve cultures, or I don't know. It's like it's an area full of landmines. We'll put it that way. Cultures are constantly changing and evolving. What we were last year will not be what we are next year. These people that I photograph, the way they were 100 years ago will not be the way they are in 100 years. For me, I'm capturing a moment in time. I'm capturing traditional cultures still adhering to their kind of traditional ways of living. We'll put it that way. And a lot of times it's the clothing they wear. There are other people who do, you know, similar type of photo projects that I'm working on, who will photograph people who they may be wearing blue jeans in one photo and they have a cell phone and then they put on their like traditional clothing and then they take the photo and then they go back out into their clothing. I have a little bit of a problem with that. I like to photograph people simply kind of as they are. Maybe they're wearing ceremonial clothes that they wouldn't wear on a daily basis, but they're not wearing, they're not that far. It's like when people, it's like you go to, I can go down a black hole with all of this, but it is not my job to preserve anything. What I'm doing is I'm capturing a moment in time of cultures that are rapidly evolving and changing. We'll put it that way.
Yeah, I think that's a really great way to sum that up. So I think that would probably tie into the next question, which is, you know, what's the core message that you're trying to communicate to your viewers? And it sounds like it's capturing that moment of time of these cultures as they are now. Would that be correct?
The core message. Let's just say life is short. We never know when the end is going to come. Whatever we decide to do, we should aim to do it with excellence and honor. My photos are of people. If one of my photos inspires one person to explore the world or inspires one person to get to know someone different than themselves, or maybe inspires one person to be the change that helps make the world a better place, like, to me, that's success. I think photography is unimportant. Everything we do really is unimportant. When you're 90 years old and looking back at your life, like, what's important? It's the relationships we've had. And if we left the world in a slightly better place than when we arrived. I don't know that there's a core message with the photos. To me, the photos are just it's just an excuse to meet these people, an excuse to interact and experience ways of thinking that are different than my own.
So. Sure. Okay. This is maybe one of my favorite images that I've ever seen. Can you talk about just this specific photo just for me? And to just, I don't know, like, there's so much happening. There's so many textures. And we have, you know, just looking at it aesthetically, there's this really lovely gradient we have coming sort of light at the top and darker at the bottom. So many things to look at. Just talk a little bit about, you know, what this shoot was like.
Well, let me tell you, this woman was cranky. She didn't. And the other thing is, this is a great example of the viewer can add so many layers of meaning to a photo that were never there. I've received so many messages on Instagram from people saying, "Oh, she's covering her face because you're stealing her soul." Et cetera. But the reality is, you know, I shot 100 photos of her and she did 100 different things. And at one point it was raining and I think she went to wipe off her eyes. So really she put her hands on her face and she was cleaning off her face. Another moment she was yelling at a dog and the photos of her yelling at the dog were amazing. She just has this like look on her face, which is like iconic. This is a great example of how hard it can be to shoot in some of these areas. It had been raining for 2 days. I was in Peru at the end of the rainy season. Some days it would be clear and then for 5 days it would rain. And when it's raining, it's just cloudy. And then I'd haul the gear up the side of a mountain. I'd know who I wanted to photograph before I photographed them. I'd haul the gear up the side of a mountain. I'd get there and the person would have left to go take care of the alpacas on the other side of the mountain. Come back the next day, and then it starts raining. This was a case of like waiting day after day. Finally, the weather cleared up just enough to photograph her and her husband, and then it started raining again. So as I'm shooting this, we have someone holding something over the lens. I was worried about the rain, like blowing out the light on the lighting. But in the end, all of that pain and frustration, if you end up with one photo that like lives on, it's all worth it. The thing is like, you're working on oil painting. I have a friend who's an oil painter. He's phenomenal. When you're doing an oil painting, you can spend days or weeks on one painting and you know where it's going. A photograph in a 250th of a second, you go from not having a photograph to having a photograph, to having an amazing photograph. Even the most iconic photos in the world were shot in less than a second. And a photo like this, it may take 5 days to even have the opportunity to be in front of the subject where you can shoot the photo. And then suddenly you have it. So, did I answer your question, Zach?
Yeah, absolutely. No, thank you for that. That's incredible.
This guy, I want to talk about this guy. This guy was awesome. He waited days to be photographed and he had a good look. I wanted to photograph him. But it was raining, it was raining, it was raining. He had never had his photograph taken. And several years ago, a photographer had come into Caros and he was scared of the photographer. I actually know who the photographer is, but he was scared of the photographer and he didn't want to be photographed. And he's probably in his 70s, maybe his late 70s, and he'd never been photographed and he didn't know what he looked like. So he waited days. Every day, his like grandson would come and ask if today was the day we could shoot. And the weather was terrible. Finally, right at dusk on like day three or day four, right at dusk, suddenly the clouds kind of cleared up. And we got him in the truck. We zoomed up the mountain. I knew where I wanted to shoot. We got him in the truck. We drove up the mountain. We get out and we start photographing. And he really wanted to see his photo. And he looked at it and he got really upset. And keep in mind, I'm working with two translators. It's myself to someone who speaks a little bit of English and Spanish, from someone who speaks Spanish to Quechua. It's back and forth. But he was upset. And he was upset, and basically in English, translated in English, he was saying, how can any woman love that ugly old man? He considered himself to be an ugly old man. He's like, how could a woman love that ugly old man? And the reality was, I thought he was incredible. But his perception of himself was very different than the reality. But he was very upset about, he wasn't upset at my photos. He was upset at the way he looked. But it's amazing when you're photographing someone who's never been photographed before, what their reactions are. In Africa, the women with all their bracelets on their arms, sometimes when they get excited, they rub the bracelets together. And that to me is like success, is when a woman sees her photo and she's like, she's so excited. And she's like kissing the camera. And it's like absolute elation. Like, you know, if you feel like you made their day, you know, that's good enough for me. And as an aside, one last thing on this topic, when I have a chance, I'll print up the photos and I'll bring them back to where I go. Because frequently I'll go back to the same location again and again. So when I have the opportunity, I go home, I print up photos and I bring them back and give them out. I just think it's, you know, if someone, you know, someone doesn't own an image of themselves, it's like the least I could do as a thank you. So.
Sure. Yeah. No, I love that. That's gotta be such a fantastic gift for someone that's never been photographed before. Now that's incredible. You know, it seems like, you know, these images are really, you know, people tend to seem, I guess not in all of them, but largely, you know, people tend to seem happy. You know, people, from the sounds of your stories, it seems like people are, you know, welcoming you to a pretty high degree. Do you ever have very much resistance? Do you have a lot of people saying, actually, no, I would prefer not? What's kind of the ratio of people that are really willing to be photographed and the people that would just rather stay away?
Most people want to be photographed. Keep in mind, we live in a world where there's cameras everywhere. Every cell phone has a camera, but I'm frequently photographing in places that you don't have cameras and you don't have people that are photographed normally. So they love seeing themselves photographed. There was one time in Africa where this woman was just grumpy. She didn't want to be photographed, but that's fine. There's 20 women who want to be photographed. I was photographing at a wedding in Africa. And of course, like, I'm respectful. I'm not going to disrupt the wedding. And at one point, one of the women wanted to be photographed. Next thing you know, the whole wedding party was over there wanting to be photographed. And I felt like that's the point where I crossed the line. I was like, here I am, like, interrupting this wedding. Meanwhile, the whole wedding started to like orbit around all the camera equipment. So rather than people not wanting to be photographed, usually it's a case of too many people want to be photographed. And how do you pick and how do you choose without insulting anyone? And sometimes you're photographing the chief. In Myanmar, I would have to photograph like some of the important people in the village in order to kind of like keep everyone happy. But it's rare that people don't want to be photographed. We'll put it that way.
Got it. That's my light there. Talk a little bit about, you know, I mean, you're at altitude here. I mean, in Patagonia, I mean, it seems like it pretty, I mean, you're dealing with sort of, you know, a lot less oxygen. You're hauling gear up. How is that, you know, is that playing a really significant role, or are you like working out prior to heading over there? Like, what does it look like when you're preparing for these trips?
Yeah. Just to clarify real quick, this is not Patagonia. This is in Peru. Andes in Peru. Yeah. This is kind of right on the eastern edge of the Andes, right before it drops in the Amazon. So all these clouds are coming up from the Amazon. High altitude, 14,000 feet, 15,000 feet. I don't know this for a fact, but I have a theory that there's more oxygen around the equator. My experience at altitude at the equator is it's a lot easier to breathe at altitude than it is in Colorado or farther north. Having said that, you're still at altitude and it's still hard to breathe and you're still hauling a lot of equipment. In Peru, I had about 100 kilos of gear in some big cases. And so I was hiring locals, maybe about $10 a day to help carry the stuff. Because when you're going up and down these mountains, oh my gosh, it can be exhausting. And there's nothing like spending 2 hours hauling gear up a mountain for someone who's supposed to be there and they're not there. And you find out that they're not going to be there for several days. You haul it back down and then the next 3 days it's raining. So you're hauling gear, but it's part of the job.
So, I feel like you've just gotten back. You've always just have gotten back from somewhere. But where are you preparing to go next?
I'm preparing to go home. I was in Myanmar. It was mid-March. I was supposed to go back to Colorado for a couple of weeks and then come to Spain and then head off to Ethiopia. I was trying to go to Iran for the month of April. All of the logistics on that couldn't come through. I was working on Morocco, was having some challenges there. So I decided to go to Ethiopia. But like I said, I was in Myanmar, shooting in Myanmar. I was in the airport. My flight got canceled. The whole COVID crisis was every day was getting more and more dramatic. Things were closing down. My flights out of Myanmar were canceled. I got another flight. I landed in Hong Kong and I was talking to my girlfriend in Spain and she says they're shutting the borders down. So I bought a one-way ticket from Hong Kong to Spain for $600 and came directly to Spain, landed in Spain, and they shut the airport. And that was it. So the first 2 months I was here, I don't think I had my computer. I was on lockdown. And now I'm heading back to the U.S. at the end of June for the month of July, looking forward to a pillow. Looking forward to some of my own stuff, yeah. But the plan will be to come back here, and then from there we'll see. Right now, with the virus crisis, it's really hard to make plans because you just don't know. You really can't plan that far ahead. So,
sure. Yeah.
So I'd love to give you an answer, but I don't have a good answer right now, other than going home.
Hey, that's an answer. That's a trip. We had a good question in the Q&A, and I'm going to kind of go through some of these right now. One question was, what kind of prompts do you use to engage people? Certain words or body language that you use? I know that you're using interpreters, and so I imagine a lot has to be done just via, your personality, your gesticulations. So are there certain things that you try to tell people in order to pose, or you just kind of let them be natural?
Well, the first thing is a smile is universal. You smile, they smile. Like people, I think people like sense the intentions of other people. Like you may have no language in common, but your body language, your general demeanor can really open someone up. And I'm a goofball when shooting. Like I'm shameless. Like I will get some 90-year-old woman dancing. If I need to dance to get her to dance, I will dance. And so a lot of the people I'm photographing, it becomes fun. I think to get a good photo, it's nice to have some emotion in your subject. And to get emotion in your subject, you need to get them to kind of calm down. No one likes to be in front of a camera, especially people who haven't been photographed. They don't know what to do. They don't know what they're doing. They don't want to mess up. They're very self-conscious. So I always try to kind of calm the situation and then really engage people. Sometimes it's with an interpreter, but usually it's just having fun. Side note here, my earbuds are about to die. So if they cut out, I will switch over to the, over to the computer. In fact, yeah, that's what I'm going to do real quick.
Okay.
Disconnect.
Well, there you go. Sounds good.
Okay, yeah. So, apologize if the acoustics are not as good as they were a second ago, but
we don't want to lose deer butts here. Yeah, I mean, it's fun. It's fun shooting people. It's fun shooting people when they are like happy and playful. And, you know, the minute you, here's what I was going to say. Kids, there are kids everywhere. If you connect with the kids, it's easy to connect with the kids. I'm on the ground wrestling with the kids. I'm like throwing them up in the air. Kids are fun. Kids are, have no like real walls. So, you know, I was with the Dashnitch tribe in southern Ethiopia, and you show up and people tend to be kind of reserved, but then the kids are like running up to you and touching you and running away, and then I'll chase them, you know, and next thing you know, the kids are tackling me. They're like climbing on, they're grabbing my hair, and I'm rolling on the ground, picking them up, throwing them, you know, and having fun. And then soon the adults like come closer, and you spend like several days with a group of people, and they start to see how you interact with the kids and then the adults. Everyone calms down and turns into a much more fun situation. You may not have language in common, but on my end, I'm trying to connect. On their end, they try to connect. So,
got it. So how long, you mentioned, you know, days at a time. How long do you typically spend at each location?
In Peru, I was there for 3 months.
Wow.
Yeah, so Peru was two trips. I was there for 6 weeks, came back for a couple weeks, and went back to Peru. Like I said before, I like to return again and again, sometimes photograph the same people again and again. I think to really understand a culture, to really understand the people, you need to do more than like drop in and drop out. Once you understand people's kind of ways of thinking and the kind of the rhythms and pace of life, is when you, this woman, she was yelling at the dog. She was very upset about this dog. But afterwards, she cooked guinea pig. She made a huge feast of about 10 guinea pigs, all for the occasion. So I learned how to cook a guinea pig.
Wow.
Yeah. All right. I can talk forever about some of these questions, so I'll let you carry on with more.
I had a good question. So are you all handheld doing this? Are you on a tripod? You know, are you moving around a lot? Like kind of what's that look like in the situation?
Handheld, moving around a lot. I have like cargo pants and a t-shirt. I'm rolling on the ground. You know, I am filthy by the end of some of these shoots. In Peru, it was muddy. It was cold. It was miserable. I am like on the ground. I'm in the dust. I'm in the water. My mind goes blank to the entire outside environment. It is me and the person I'm photographing. There may be 200 people watching. I'm like backing up into people. I'm like tripping over things. My mind is entirely focused on the subject. It's all handheld, but I'm in a zone. I'm in a zone when I'm shooting. This woman, I have a lot of photos of her. She was a phenomenal human. She was like, probably, I think she was 93. A lot of these people are very short. So I take all of my boxes, my camera gear, and I stack it up and I have them standing on top because I can't get low enough to photograph some of them. Some of these people I'm sitting on the ground shooting, trying to like get low enough so I'm not like photographing down on top of them. But this woman looked just like this, I'll tell you that.
I was gonna ask, so I mean, my initial gut reaction is that like she's furious at you, but I don't think that's the case. I don't think that's the case at all. So how was this interaction like?
Well, this interaction actually was funny. Through a translator, I wanted her to give me advice on marriage and how to find a wife. So, you know, it's like you're photographing these old women, they have all sorts of advice. So through the translator, I wanted her, this woman, to give me advice on love and marriage and how to find a wife. So she was going on and on. She's waving her hands at me. I have no idea what she was saying. Everyone was laughing and I was just shooting. This is just one of her many expressions about love and marriage.
So. Wow, that's amazing. No, it's so striking, just immediately striking. Are we still in Peru here?
I don't think it's a great photo, but I did include this just because of, if you look at her forehead, if you look at the detail, these are low-res images that you're pulling up right now, but the camera really just captures a phenomenal, like, the textures. I mean, it's just phenomenal
But yeah, and this is, like I said, these are low res. In the actual images, those eyelashes are crystal clear. You can photograph someone from 20 feet away and count every individual eyelash. It's amazing.
Unbelievable. Such a striking image. And so where are we now? Are we in the same location as the past one?
Different location, but still Africa. This woman, I love it. She was a gem of a human. You know, a lot of these people, when they're being photographed, they love to look very serious. And then you like stop shooting and they start smiling and laughing and wanting to see the camera. And then you pull up the camera again, they look serious. This woman, and another thing is like when after you photograph people, a lot of times they somehow feel like they can help you out. So after I photographed this woman, she was like helping coordinate other people. And she's like starting to try to art direct people. It's always funny when you have like seven people art directing with the person you're trying to shoot and you're trying to get the person to do something that they're not. I mean, it can turn into chaos. So,
okay. Wow.
But it's all fun. I actually had on this particular shoot, there were two women who got in a fight over who got to be photographed. And I was like, I wasn't choosing who to photograph. They just got in a fight thinking only one of them could be photographed. I photographed both of them, but they were rolling on the ground, very upset about who's going to get to be photographed. I was like, I'll photograph both of you. It's okay. So
I love that. That's fantastic. All right, guys, I think.
Where in the U.S. or Europe will you ever have two people fighting over to be photographed? I mean, look at this.
I don't know. I think the fight would be very different. I think it would be for a very different reason, but yeah. I don't know. Maybe. So I think we're kind of coming to the end of the third segment, but we have a lot of questions that I'd like to get through. So we'll kind of go ahead and knock those out. I have a question here. Somebody's asking if you're using a waist level finder in order to maintain eye contact, or are you using a prism finder that comes standard on the exit?
Prism finder. Sometimes I'll hold the camera down, especially when someone is very shy about being photographed. They want to be photographed, but they sometimes people get like the minute you pull the camera up, they lose their ease. So sometimes I'll just hold it and I'll just shoot like this, and I'll get a lot of missed shots. But every now and then you'll get something good. But yeah, just through a prism.
Okay, got it. Great question. Somebody asked, do you have any behind the scenes images or videos of you? I feel like it would be so entertaining to, I mean, you describe yourself as being so animated. I'd love to watch that. Do you have any, is there somewhere we can go to see anything like that?
I do have behind the scenes stuff, but it's just casual stuff that's been shot on my cell phone. I think moving into the future, I'll shoot more behind the scenes stuff.
Yeah. I think a lot of people would really enjoy seeing that. Did you, when you were in Ethiopia, how long were you there, and what do you recommend visiting while you were there? It seems to be a large place.
I was in Ethiopia for about a month. The Omo Valley is in southern Ethiopia. It's a phenomenal place. The Omo Valley, if you read about it, there's you'll read a lot of good and read a lot of bad. There are probably 15, 16, 17 tribes in that area. And you do get tourism. You do get people who go to photograph. In fact, this particular photograph was shot in a village that does get people going into photograph. I like to shoot areas that are still kind of living by their cultural traditions and not dressing up for photo shoots. In Ethiopia, photographing the Omo Valley, 95% of what I shot was in villages that are so far off the beaten path that they're not getting tourists. But there are villages in southern Ethiopia that do have kind of a tourist traffic go through them, and then the people will dress up. This particular woman is probably dressed like this simply because she's been photographed before and she knows what people like to be photographed, to be honest. But if someone were to go to the Omo Valley, you need to work with a guide that has the ability to get way off the beaten path, which usually means hiking through the bush, sometimes miles and miles off the roads.
Okay. Your when you're shooting, some of these technical questions that I think should be asked, are you using autofocus? Are you manually focusing? How are you focusing in?
Autofocus. Yeah. Autofocus. Sometimes manual. Sometimes manual if the lighting is causing some problems. But in general, autofocus. So.
So most of these images are of single people, are of single individuals. Do you ever photograph or have any intention of photographing in the future, you know, like groups or couples, pairs? Is that a conscious choice?
Yeah, I think long term, yeah, I'd love to shoot more environmental stuff. To be honest, I'm still kind of deciding what I like and what I like and don't like, and doing a lot of experimenting still at this point. I love individuals and I love the stories that you see in people's faces. I love, once you start shooting groups of people, you end up with an entirely different kind of story, so to speak. But I think moving into the future, I'll be shooting more, larger groups of people.
Got it. Okay. You know what, guys, I think, you know, there's a few more questions, but you know, we're coming up approaching the end of the talk, and I think we've got a few other things to do.
If we ask the questions, I'll make them really quick. So if someone asks them, I'll answer them. Be quick with them.
All right. Let me see if I can find a new one that can. The question has to have a simple answer, though.
I can. Yes.
So you're using a battery pack on location, right? I assume that there's not just one 20 volt or 220 volt out somewhere.
Yes. Yes.
Yes. Battery pack. Okay, got it. Yeah, I think that's the, I'm sure I'm missing some somewhere, but I think that's the largest part of the questions. Are there other, this is a good one. Were you inspired by any specific other photographers to begin doing work like this, or was this something that you've been planning on doing for a while and kind of separated?
This is something I've been planning on doing for a while. There's a lot of great photographers out there, a lot of photographers who shoot in genres entirely different than what I'm shooting in. Rather than name specific photographers, it's a very diverse democratic medium. For me, this has just been something I've been wanting to do for a long time. I don't consider myself to be a photographer as much as, I don't know, it's just more of an artist who happens to use photography as a medium. So.
Okay. Got it. Well, I think now it's time to announce the winners of the last question, and I think start to tie things off. So, Murray, if you're there and available,
I'm here.
There you are.
All right, guys. So, for everybody that was part of the second question, that one was, what lens does Leif enjoy shooting most often? And Cameron D. from the U.S. answered correctly with Schneider Kreuznach 55 millimeter. Back to you, Zach.
Thanks, Murray. So, I think we're starting to wrap up. Leif, do you have any kind of closing thoughts for people that are really interested in your work, or maybe making work somewhat similar to it? You know, what kinds of things has this experience taught you?
I mean, I think at the end of the day, humans are all the same. We think we're different, but we're all the same. We live on a small little orb floating around in a vast amount of space. Like, different people and different cultures, they're not threats. They give us opportunities to learn, to love, and to expand our ideas on life and living. I think diversity should be cherished and appreciated and respected. You know, our lives are the sum cumulative total of every decision we've ever made. And when I reach the end of the line, I hope I can look back and say it was a life well lived. I've met people from all over the world, and the more people I meet, the more kind of optimistic I am about, you know, the world as a whole. Like, it's a beautiful place and full of many beautiful people and many beautiful cultures. And I don't know what to say. That's kind of how I feel in the moment right now. So
that's wonderful. I think it's a lovely sentiment. Leif, thank you so much for spending time with us. Thank you so much for sharing your thoughts and sharing these incredible images. To all of our attendees, thank you guys so much for being here. We really hope you enjoyed it. We hope you're all safe and taking care of yourselves as we all go through this thing. Thank you so much for watching. Thank you for being here. If you're interested in any of the equipment or phase one products that we talked about during the video. Do know that we are offering, both phase one and MegaPixels Digital are offering online demos. So not necessarily in person right now, but we have webinar-based demos, somewhat like this, where we can talk to you, answer questions, and just kind of talk shop and talk gear. So please do know that. Again, thank you guys so much for being here. We truly appreciate it. Leif, thank you. Stay safe out there, and yeah, we'll see you next time. Thanks, everyone.
Cool. Thank you, everyone.